Tell me, what do you do with witches?
We have found a witch, may we burn her?
Burn her!
Burn her! Who do you know she is a witch?
She looks like one!
Yeah, she looks like one!
Bring her forward.
This tale of witches takes us to Lancashire, in England. It's the 17th century, and the man that sits atop the English throne, James I, has developed a fixation with witchcraft. The shadow of the Witchcraft Act of 1562 loomed large. Anyone who should use, practice, or exercise any witchcraft, enchantment, charm, or sorcery, whereby any person shall happen to be killed or destroyed, was guilty of a felony without benefit of clergy, and was to be put to death. The ground was ripe for injustice brought about by misunderstanding and petty squabbling. In 1612, every keeper of the peace was tasked with compiling a list of all those who refused to attend the church and take communion. At the time, this was a criminal offence. Under the 1558 Recusancy Acts, any person who was considered loyal to the Catholic Church by refusing to attend Church of England services, for example, could be fined, had their property confiscated, or even be imprisoned. The Keeper of the Peace in Pendle, in Lancashire, was a man named Roger Knowle. In March of that year, 1612, a complaint of witchcraft would arrive at his door and kickstart a tragic chain of events. It's important to note here that the villages of Pendle contained several healers who were considered witches of sorts, by themselves and others. This without causing any harm to others, of course. The encounter that changed this attitude occurred on the 21st of March 1612. On her way to Trawden Forest, a parish in Pendle, villager Alison Device encountered John Law, a travelling vendor from Halifax. Seeing he was a man of wares, she asked him for some pins. The pins were intricate and highly sought after for healing purposes, amongst other magical pursuits. Knowing their worth, Law was reluctant to part with them. The details of this transaction and how it went awry have blurred with the passing of time. Suddenly, Law was overcome by the appearance of a large black dog with fiery eyes. The animal form spoke in English, offering to inflict harm upon him at the behest of Device. Alarmed and at pains to flee, Law tripped and fell to the ground. Recovering himself, he fled to a nearby tavern, leaving Device alone on the path. For whatever reason, rather than claim innocence and question Law's sanity, Alison Device accepted blame, her own powerful ability to summon the devil in canine form, when visited by Law's son, Abraham. Not long after, Device, her mother Elizabeth, and brother James were summoned before Knowle for a full account of Alison's deeds. While her brother revealed Alison's confession at bewitching a local child, her mother was more resistant to interrogation. She declared only her own mother, Demdike, bore a mark on her body, believed to be a trace left by the devil himself. Talk about throwing your mother under the bus. When questioned about a rival family, the Tuttocks, also implicated in tales of witchcraft about Pendle, Alison spied an opportunity for retribution. Historically, the families had been at war since the Devices accused the Chattox family of stealing a sizeable sum from them. In the moment, Alison declared the Chattox family had murdered four men by witchcraft, as well as her father, John Device, who died in 1601. Consequently, in April of 1612, Demdike, Alison's grandmother, Chattox and Chattox's daughter, Anne Redfern, were summoned to appear before Knowle. Now, both Demdike and Chattox were elderly at this time, and readily provided Knowle with confessions. Both confessed to giving their soul away to a higher power, the devil or a thing like a Christian man, whatever that may be. Anne Redfern made no such confession, however. Unfortunately for her, Demdike declared that she'd seen her making clay figures, whilst another witness, Margaret Crook, claimed that her brother had fallen ill and died after having had a disagreement with Redfern, damning testimony indeed. It was enough for Knowle. All four women, Demdike, Chattox, Anne Redfern, and Alison Device, were all sent to Lancashire Jail to be tried for malfeasance, causing harm by witchcraft. At this point, post-trial, post-conviction, the matter would have been closed, but Elizabeth Device had other plans. Elizabeth gathered friends and supporters to a meeting at Malkin Tower, home of the Demdike family. Word of this gathering reached the ears of Mr. Knoll, and following a new inquiry, 8 more people were accused of witchcraft. Never mind that her husband had stolen a neighbour's livestock to cater for the party. Of the two, theft and witchcraft, the latter was clearly considered a harsher crime. All the new defendants were sent to Lancashire Jail to join Demdike Chattox, Redfern and Device, bar Jeanette Preston, who resided in nearby Yorkshire, and was, incidentally, the first to be tried. Her crime was the murder of a local landowner by witchcraft. The evidence? According to witnesses at a viewing of the body, fresh blood oozed from the corpse after Preston had touched it. The remainder of the accused lived in Lancashire. Anne Whittle was accused of the murder of Robert Nutter. Although pleading not guilty, her confession, made to Roger Knoll, was read out in court, and witnesses declared she was believed to be a witch and had been accused of poisoning the victim's beer. Elizabeth Device was tried for the murders of James Robinson, John Robinson, and together with Alice Nutter and Demdike, the murder of Henry Mitten. The former maintained her innocence throughout the trial and was horrified when her own daughter, 9-year-old Jeanette Device, was brought forward to testify against her and other members of the family. Screaming bloody murder at her young daughter, she was promptly escorted from the courtroom. According to the girl, her mother had been a witch for several years, and she kept a familiar in the house in the form of a brown dog. James Device, Elizabeth's son, also gave evidence against her, claiming he'd seen her make a clay figure of one of the victims, again with the clay figures. Clearly they missed Vin Diesel's speech on the importance of family. Jeanette Device would go on to testify against many of the remaining defendants. James, in turn, pleaded not guilty to the murders of Anne Townley and John Duckworth. His confession to Knoll was also read out in court, however, and with his sister declaring she'd seen him talking to a dog, seeking support with the murders, his guilt was a no-brainer. Anne Redfern was faced with the murder of Robert Nutter's father, Christopher. Much like Elizabeth Device, she too claimed her innocence. Despite witnesses testifying that she was a very dangerous witch indeed, and she too was a creator of the clay figures, fate sealed. On to Jane Bolcock and her son John, facing allegations of murdering Jeanette Dean. Despite their claims of not being present at the Malkin Tower meeting, Jeanette Device asserted that Jane was among those in attendance. Additionally, John was identified as the person responsible for manning the spit at their infamous Good Friday gathering. Alice Nutter maintained a reserved demeanour throughout the trial, refraining from making any statement save a not guilty plea to the accusation of using witchcraft to murder Henry Mitten. So, the allegation goes, Nutter, Demdike and Elizabeth Device caused the death of Mitten after he refused to give coin to a begging Demdike. With regards to the Malkin Tower meet, it's possible she attended briefly, but chose to remain silent, careful not to implicate her fellow Catholics, including family members, and risk further accusations of a different nature. Catherine Hewitt was charged with the murder of Anne Folds. She had attended the Malkin Tower affair with Alice Gray and was allegedly overheard discussing the murder of the child with Gray, also a defendant. And at last, Alison Device, charged with causing harm by witchcraft. The only one to be confronted by her victim in court, she expressed extreme remorse and begged forgiveness of John Law. 9 of those on trial were found guilty and hung at Gallows Hill in August 1612. Another died whilst awaiting trial, and only one, Alice Gray, was found not guilty. All their fates had been sealed by confessions under torture, spurious evidence gathered by the Pendle Keeper of the Peace, Roger Knoll, and the words of a 9-year-old girl cajoled into testimony. Jump to the present day, and there's an active petition calling for the pardon of the Pendle Witches. It's fortunate the law has been amended somewhat since the 17th century. Social media would be rife with accusations of sorcery. Clay figures would become avatars and profile pictures. It's hard to believe the fates of so many were decided on the basis of so little.
Right, remove the supports!
Away! Away!
It's a fair crop.
Thanks very much for listening. If you'd like to contact us or check out what we've been up to, you can find us on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook. If you enjoyed the video today, please do like it, subscribe to the channel, and ding the bell to receive notifications about new videos. See you in the next one.